show the clip later was $60,000.
Right.
How much did you pay?
A lot less. But on the other hand, it was rusted to pieces, and my wife and I drove it back, and it's been in the body shop almost continuously since then.
Tell me, armor-plated?
Yes, armor-plated here, bulletproof glass
bulletproof there.
If you're a mafia king, here's your chance for a great buy.
You're doing a commercial now for yours, too.
Right.
This was one they bought after the kidnapping of the High Commissioner.
It was built because of
the FLQ crisis.
Well, she shipped to Canada.
David, I'm very grateful to you, and I'd like you just to pick me up every morning in the spring, 5:30, drop me here at 6 o'clock.
10% of your annual income, and it's a deal.
Well, don't let the tax department know. They'll try and give me a taxable benefit imputed to my income from one run in this gorgeous vehicle. Thank you very much, David.
Jack, it's been a pleasure.
Good morning. The Webster program today is going to be a little bit varied, to say the least. And the first item on the program will be the answer to the question, will Gary Watt, the 31-year-old quadriplegic from Ontario, who until Steve Wyatt stepped in was stuck in bed in hospital, will he be home for Christmas? Also on the program this morning, we're going to have Michael Harcourt. We might give him our report card, or he might give us his report card. And many other interesting items on the show this morning. But first, after the break, here's Worship Mike Harcourt. Tuesday, my friend, did I say that? Yes. Mike Harcourt, the mayor of Vancouver, will have completed 1 year. He has left behind him a string of successes or a tangle of failures, depending on which side of the political spectrum you happen to sit. I merely have a few simple questions which I want his worship. I don't want him to behave like Bill Bennett or Ray Perot or any of these long-winded politicians. I want him to give me short, clipped answers to my simple, straightforward questions. Would you accept the wish for Merry Christmas?
I will accept that and return it.
Good.
Merry Christmas to you.
Well, I was downtown yesterday on the old Wasserman Beat, and I met many of the people of whom you are well aware. The very prosperous hookers in downtown Vancouver. And they wanted me to give you their very best regards because you and the rest of you in authority have made business never better, nor more prosperous, nor more voluminous. And I trust you accept their warm and grateful thanks for the increase in their turnover of business.
Turnover, that's the word you're using, are you, Jack?
Don't push it any further,
okay,
Mike.
Okay, well, I think they're whistling past the graveyard, because the stories I have is it's a lean year, and it's going to get even leaner when we have some decent federal legislation. Bring some peace and quiet.
Let's move a resolution. I move, seconded by you, that the reason for this nonsense in the streets of Vancouver is entirely the incompetence and blind-sightedness of the Federal Minister of Justice.
Right.
Agreed?
Absolutely.
I hope he hears. Now, next question. How do you plead as part of the triumvirate which has left us with that ugly, dirty scar at the waterfront in Vancouver, Pier BC? Guilty or not guilty?
Plead to what? What's the charge, Jack?
Charges,
I'm going to accept a plea. I want to know what
the charge
is.
That you are part of a triumvirate which has seen this ghastly political nonsense whereby Pier BC is going to sit there and rot as it did for years.
Well, I plead as a supporter of the need for a trade and conference center. This city has outgrown its facilities. When you have the BC Federation of Labor, the Canadian Medical Association having to meet the cow barns out of the PNE, you know we need a new facility. So I'm a supporter. I want a sensible, well-done trade and conference.
And you were not involved in the final kerfuffles.
Except as you are, as a horrified spectator watching this tussle of two giants trying to decide who is to blame, where we should go from here.
I find you not guilty.
Thank you very much.
Right? Is that any
good decision? A very just and merciful decision.
I find you not guilty. Now, what I'd like to do now, and you say Merry Christmas to the stadium downtown. It is a magnificent building, and I've got to give the social credit great credit. And Alvin Nairod and the Englishman Hartman and Manning, they've done a magnificent job. you say yes, you agree they've done a magnificent job.
On the construction, they've done an excellent job. They're ahead of schedule. They're under budget. And all they have to do, Jack, is to catch up on the traffic, the transit problems, the impact of the surrounding communities, some items like that. But I want to let you know that a week and a half ago, I was back in Toronto meeting with Jean Drapeau, with Paul Godfrey, the chairman of Metro Toronto, the mayor of Toronto, Art Eggleton. They're all going to help us get a baseball team.
Yes, yes. Will that be Scalpania?
No.
Well, someday. Would you like to send a personal message to Frank Griffiths first?
Yeah.
Helen Schwangard second on this talk, which I find exceedingly difficult to digest, that the Canucks might dare to leave Vancouver for Meadowlands or Dallas or anywhere else.
No.
What do you say to Frank?
I'm going to quote that famous philosopher Snoopy. Hang in there, Frank.
Hang in there, Frank.
Hang in there.
I don't
and Irwin,
think.
Too. If Irwin, I think if Irwin was to practice that famous old maxim of honey and vinegar, I think it may speed up the negotiations.
Wouldn't it be better if Irwin just kept that wonderful voluminous mouth of his a little shut more tightly?
Or if it was open, that he practiced honey and instead of vinegar.
Honey and vinegar, as you do with counsel, right? You were given by your colleagues an A for effort, right? And a C plus for performance. You accept the rating as your first year at Mayor.
I think I have worked hard. I think I've done a good job in terms of moving business along.
What is your
Jack?
Own rating on yourself?
I give myself an A for effort and a B for results.
B for performance.
B for performance.
All right. I'd like you to give me your verbal Christmas presents to the members of your council. Don Bellamy.
Well, I've already given them the presents, Jack. And
put it in words for me.
And I'll say them very crisply as
please.
You request. Given Bellamy a Toastmaster Award for speeches under 30 seconds. Keep it up, Don.
God bless Don. Nellie Boyce.
For Alderman Boyce to help her along, I gave her another 200 delegate votes at the Point Grey Social Credit Nominating Convention.
So she can be great? No, who's she?
Whoever's going to run out there.
You want her on social credit, you don't want her on council.
It's just a Christmas present to my friend Helen.
Brown, Alderman May Brown.
Alderman Brown is very interested in Sunday shopping, so I awarded her a free shopping pass to London Drugs on Sundays in Burnaby.
Okay. The incredible
Nathan Davinsky?
Davinsky.
Well, because we can't get him on a diet and because he likes to eat, I've awarded him a free city council placemat and serving set for his coffee and donuts in the morning and his fruit in the afternoon.
The intrepid Erickson.
The intrepid Erickson with the perfect attendance record. We've given him a report card with a gold star for perfect attendance.
Ford, Alderman Ford.
Well, Alderman Ford, I thought, could sit down at a lunch out of the mayor's fund with one of our developers in town, Andre Mulder, to explain to him the concepts greed, profit, and the development process.
How about giving Mulder a tape measure? Then we come to our mutual friend who's not very well at the moment.
Yes, and we
Walnut
wish him well.
Kennedy.
We wish him well. He is quite ill in Centennial Pavilion, and we do wish him well. I hope he's watching.
Take it
to
full recovery.
I awarded him the Plaid Tongue Award.
Plaid Tongue Award.
The Plaid Tongue Award. And
Tartan Tongue.
Well, it's
the award of the Tartan Tongue.
The award of the Tartan Tongue, and also he's been working on a civic flag for 5 years now, so we hope he finally comes up with one this year.
How about a wee tough guy? Georgie, baby.
Georgie
Buell.
We thought that George needed to deal with his body language, so we awarded him body language lessons from Olga at Vivas for use in council and classroom.
Now, to the real socialist of the council, not the milk and water NDPer that you are, to the real socialist, Harry Rankin, what do you give?
Harry, we gave, because he is the dean of council, we gave him two presents. First of all, a book on how to influence your enemies, and how to make your point in under 45 minutes.
Harry couldn't do it in under 45 minutes if you paid him. And of course, to Comrade York, the man in the very well-fitted sports jacket.
Well,
Comrade York.
As you know, Alderman York is a member of the PNE board, and he and Irwin Swangard get along most famously. So what I did is I decided to have them make amends in 82, so I awarded them both a weekend trip to Afghanistan.
Excellent idea. They could patch up their social and international difficulties at the same time. I want you, dear callers, dear viewers, this is our last live show before the Christmas holiday. I want you succinctly, I have a thing about people being succinct, to give your Christmas greetings to Mayor Harcourt, who despite his appearance is only 38. And it looks like that man in the commercial, there's a commercial with your lookalike, and to any members of council if you so wish. One segment, sharp, intelligent, bright calls after the break. I'm not going to nag you about strike or the garbage, and I find Reva Dest a charming person, and I promise in the new year to be slightly less of the world's worst male chauvinist pig, if I possibly can. I'm just going to go to the phones. Go ahead to his worship.
Hello.
Hello.
May I speak to Mr. Harcourt, please?
Madame, when you call here and I say go ahead, he is here waiting all agog.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Harcourt?
Yes, ma'am.
I would like to say thank you for a job well done, and a very Merry Christmas to you, to Mr. Erickson, and to Mr. Rankin.
Thank you, ma'am. No comment necessary. Go ahead, please.
Yes, why did you launch the annual parade of gays, Mayor Caligula? Was it because that you wanted to make Vancouver a spectacle, or just to get votes, or is it that your own sexual persuasion is AC-Doocy?
Oh, now that's disgusting, and I'm not going to take that kind of thing at all. Oh, what a, just watch my lips moving, nobody can hear me outside. The guy made a slimy, sneaky, horrible, nasty remark, and I just took him off the air before he reached the bureau.
Okay.
It wasn't particularly about you or about me, it was just a tasteless boor. What a thing to do to spoil a happy program, you twit. Now, I'll say it again, you twit. I'm talking to that tasteless boor. You want to complain to CRTC, send a copy to me. Go ahead, please.
Mayor Harcourt.
Yes, sir.
I don't understand why they don't do anything about the traffic situation in Vancouver.
I wanted Christmas presents.
I've been traveling 6 years now.
Hold on, please. What are you going to do about the traffic situation in Vancouver?
Well, we're suffering on our own growth, sir. There's just too many cars and trucks and vans for the road systems we've got. With a terrible transit system. So what we're trying to do is to improve the transit system and use our streets better by a whole bunch of initiatives we're going to take in the new year. But we've just got too many people driving too many cars.
Wish him a Merry Christmas.
I wish him a happy, happy, safe Christmas and miss the roadblocks.
Yeah, and if you get nailed for impaired, you deserve it. And I hope if it's a second offense, you go straight to jail. West, not you, sir. Anybody out there with a guilty conscience. Go ahead from West home.
Yes, I'd like to wish Mayor Harcourt, seeing as how he's so interested in business girls, very...
He is not. I raised the question.
Well, I think you should get, for a Christmas present, 6 hours with the best business girl in town.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Refuse that offer at once. Refuse it at once.
Listen, what do you mean refuse it? I won't even think about it. I've got my Norwegian wife, who you know is a fierce Viking and knows karate. I'm not even going to think about it.
Go ahead, please.
Hello.
That's you.
Christmas gift for Mayor Harcourt.
Yes.
A toupee for the cold weather.
A toupee for the cold weather. I resemble that remark.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, and a very Merry Christmas to you and your nice Norwegian wife from another Norwegian.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Tusen tak.
Go ahead, please. Hello.
Jack.
That's me.
Oh, yes. Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Good morning, sir.
Season's greetings and all that there stuff to you and the council. I got a question for you, but I...
Go ahead, shoot.
Don't think you want to answer it.
Well, no, go ahead.
Why were the roadblocks put up in the West End, and how's that going to divert the prostitutes and so forth and so forth?
Ten second answer.
It was put up as a temporary measure to show the people there we mean business and to get the Justice Minister to finally act to get some decent laws so we can permanently remove some of that riffraff from the streets.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
That's you, sir.
Yes, the best to the mayor.
Thank you, sir.
One thing he could do to speed up traffic, instead of 4 to 6, make it 3 to 6, because by the time they get the moved, it's 5 o'clock. Secondly, surely the provincial
three to six we're thinking of.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, three to six, yeah, we're looking at that for next year.
I sometimes long for the good old dreadful days of Buster's, and I'm looking at the positive side, not the negative side.
Buster's
when
is still
active.
used to hold
a fleet of things in the courtyard of the old courthouse, and they would have downtown Vancouver cleaned in a flash.
Yeah. Well, that's, let me tell you, in 82, one piece of bad news for bad drivers is we are going to crack down on not only drinking drivers, but bad drivers, erratic drivers, and people that are blocking up the streets, whether it's delivery vans or whatever. So we're going back to the good old days of Buster's.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
That's you, sir?
Yes, Mayor Harcourt. Merry Christmas to you and your family. I have a question about housing.
Go ahead, sir.
I phoned Webster before. I live in the apartment block in the West End that's got six empty suites in it because there's a development permit application on the front lawn. They won't let, the city won't let the owners rent the suites, whereas there are, say, 16 at least or more suites that are being lived in now. And these other suites that they can't rent are perfectly good.
Okay, we've got the point.
Yeah, I don't know anything about it, the particular project, Jack. If it's 1867 Barclay that he's talking about, then I have a very simple answer. If the people are trying to get around our bylaws indirectly, we're not going to let them.
You know, I can't expect people to come up well-briefed with Christmas presents, because normally I encourage them to nag people like you. But this morning I am in the Christmas spirit, in the best possible manner. And I trust that you managed to tie together that disparate body of strange people who act as your aldermen. I mean, I think that York has been incredibly modest, hasn't he?
He has, and he's participated. Matter of fact, I think people have underestimated how hard this council has worked in a very difficult period. You know, you look at all those big projects, difficult times, they've worked hard.
Jack Vorich gave me a Christmas message, a Christmas present for you.
Yes.
And he wants to see you running for mayor and Harry Rankin running for mayor to split the socialist and the real NDP and the real socialist vote so that he can come back again. Now, what do you say to Jack?
Well, I say I hope Jack is enjoying his continued use of the limousine, which he's still leasing. I'm using my rabbit.
Whose limousine?
Well, the limousine that he used to drive in.
He pays for the lease.
He's leasing it back. I sent it back to the leasing company.
Oh, I see.
And secondly, I'm pleased to add one police officer to the beat to fight crime, because the chauffeur is now back fighting crime instead of driving me around. And may I also wish him, and I mean this seriously, I wish him and his family well, and I hope that things look up in 1982 for him and his family.
Oh, good. From all of us to all of you.
Except politically.
Except politically. From all of us to all of you, including Harry Rankin, a very Merry Christmas. Happy, prosperous, trouble-free, and rancorous New Year.
Thank you.
My thanks to Mayor Harcourt. I don't know what's happening next this morning. We'll find out after the break. I mean, I wouldn't watch this program at all. Quiet. Can we have some quiet around here this morning, please? Steve, on Monday, I put Steve onto a story. You took kind of a little heartbreak story. These things are difficult to follow and they're difficult sometimes to understand. But this was a simple case where a mother who had come up from Ohio phoned us. Steve went to see her. And her son was really quite a tragic case. He was dead. You tell the story, Steve.
Well, Dorothy Schultz, a mother, phoned us and told us about Gary Watt, her son, who was in BGH, had been in a car accident in Cranbrook in mid-August, has been flat on his back. He's basically quadriplegic now. And he wants to go back to Ontario where the rest of his family is to spend the time there now.
His wife and his children.
That's right. And he had been trying to get back, and he can't afford it. Everybody's broke. The mother had been coming out here, spending a lot of time here. She had been put up in the nurse's residence in VGH.
He's in VGH.
That's right.
Quadriplegic, at least, for the moment.
That's right.
Living on oxygen.
That's right.
Covered by BCHIS. But you found out a number of things very quickly, which were?
Well, first of all, he wants to go home, and the Ministry of Health first told us that they don't pay for that. They can't pay to send him back to Ontario. Their air ambulance service just covers BC. So we talked to the emergency health services people. They told us, well, it might be cheaper to send him back to Ontario because he needs 2 years worth of possible treatment.
Minimum.
That's right. So we talked to them about that, and then the gears started working within the government, and it turns out now that they will pay his way back to Ontario.
So first of all, you established, one, he was covered by BCHIS, but
That's
there.
Right. Yeah, the BC Medical will pay him for the first 3 months in Ontario, and then he will reapply for the Ontario hospitalization
plan. Covered by them.
By them for the rest of
and
the time.
Only snag about getting him home was that the regulations say on the face of it, we can't ship a guy from a hospital in BC to a guy to Ontario.
That's right, because he was a new resident in BC.
A new resident. So you folks, the doctor, was a doctor?
Dr. Steinbach here in town, and Dr. Ransford from the Emergency Health Services, and then a Dr. Gervin in Ontario.
And they were all very cooperative?
Oh, yes, very.
Including Jim Nielsen, the Minister of Health, who must give him the proper credit, and Pete Pazowski, his deputy. And you got the decision when?
Yesterday afternoon.
And the decision is?
That the ministry will pay for his trip back home.
So he'll have to go home in a stretcher and a commercial
right.
aircraft, properly
That's
attended
right.
to. Go into hospital, hopefully by Christmas, do you think?
Oh, absolutely. I talked to the two doctors, one at this end and one at the other end, and got them together, and the doctor in Ontario was ready to take him anytime. The people out here are ready to send him.
Well, there's a very good Christmas for Gary, Christmas present for Gary Watt, 31, and for his mother, Mrs. Schultz.
Yes, Dorothy Schultz.
Dorothy Schultz.
And we'd like to thank all those people who phoned in and offered to send Gary back. It was very generous.
Yeah, we got offers of money and other kinds of help, but and this was a case where the bureaucrats who sometimes get the wrong side of my tongue, well, couldn't have been more cooperative nor helpful in a very human situation, and for that they deserve thanks.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Now, to something a little funnier. When was I did that crazy program with my friend Murchie, the coffee merchant, tea merchant, when he set out to build this car for next to nothing to supply cheap electric-driven battery-operated transportation? When did I do that?
That was November 4th, 1980, and you'll remember that Pat McGeer was on the show with you, and there was a deal struck. And Murchie was here, and Pat McGeer was here, and he was going to build you a car within 10 days, and if he could do it, Pat McGeer was going to buy it, and you were going to eat it.
That's right. So he built it in 10 days. I ate the mirror, which was
That's
marzipan.
Right. Right.
Like I needed it.
And we have tape of that somewhere where we can show you step by step what happened and now what's become of the Murchie car.
Now, okay,
That's
they're
right.
going to roll your
right.
ENG.
And
I
we'll
can light a cigarette. You
we'll
can tell the story.
We'll start from day one.
I'm proposing that within 10 days we have something you can look at.
Okay, if you have, I'll eat it.
Webster said it on his program that he'd eat my car if we have one. I'm going to challenge the committee this afternoon. We haven't got any stock off.
Oh, quite the idea. He'll make it, you'll buy it, and I'll eat it. All it takes is. And believe it or not, in less than 10 days production time, the car was presented at the back door, and yours truly drove in Murchie's instant people's car. Low gas mileage, gas or natural gas, low cost. And there I am hitting the doorpost, the first accident in Murchie 1, the very first. I have now stuck it on the doorpost. I have to eat the car. Have I to eat the
Jack,
car?
Jack, if you eat that car, you're a true Scotchman, keeping your word, lad.
I may keep my word, but I'll not keep my weight. This is the mirror of the car. It's made of marzipan.
You have gained weight since then, I think.
Stop it! You're fired! You're finished!
Oh no, there goes my future. Anyway, remember after that that you fulfilled your part of the bargain, Murchie fulfilled his, but Pat McGeer still hasn't bought the prototype, and we went out to find out whatever happened to Murchie. Sometimes, Jack, we just miss the obvious. Which brings us here to Murchie's warehouse down near False Creek. And it was here, amongst the boxes of tea and bales of coffee, that we found the Murch One. It's a bit covered in dust, but nevertheless intact and ready to roll again. And this is what Murchie One is about to look like, a brand new design put together by a fella by the name of David Lewis. That's the new design, and they think they're going to be in production by next year. And Murchie has even come up with an idea of a bus. He's going to pass this along to the city and the rapid transit people. It operates on the same principle. And a brand new engine, too. It's called the James engine.
Jeez, I thought that was an X-ray of his stomach.
It could be. After that marzipan mirror, I think it's yours. And this is what it's going to look like inside. All the designs are advancing quite nicely. It'll seat five people and put that brand new engine in the back. And this is David Lewis. He's an invention developer. That's right. And he says that 4 out of 10 North Americans will buy this car.
What makes it a success right now is that it's easy to enter the industry. You're not having to fight Detroit or fight Japan. You've got
Where can you
upset
fight
us
the
here.
Goliaths like that?
It's because they've gone in the wrong direction. They have not learned from the horse and buggy stage that to separate their habitat from their suspension and create safety of, instead of going to the body and looking at for your protection.
Is that what this is, a return of the horse and buggy days?
It's taking the concept of a habitat, a separate habitat, versus trying to make your whole frame and body as one. It separates the habitat from like a component stage, so that if there's any damage, you can remove the habitat, or the habitat can be as a total separate unit.
But it's so ugly.
Yeah, this is just a proof of concept. It's strictly not the product engineering.
Now what will
it's
change on it then? What will look different?
A complete new body will look more or less like an airplane wing. It will have bring the car into the aeronautical stage. It will have the aerodynamics of an airplane. And being so light, approximately 700 pounds, which is unheard of, it gives you the ability to create lots of room. You don't need a big engine. You're only looking at 18 horsepower to have the pep of a rabbit.
What kind of fuel?
It could be anything. It could be gasoline, any grade, using the James engine, or you can get engines that will run on propane.
Natural gas?
Natural gas, diesel, alcohol.
But won't all those tanks make it too heavy to drive?
No, because your weight factor, even with five passengers, is still well below the average weight of a car without any passengers in.
When do you think this thing will be on the market, where I can go out and buy one in a showroom?
I'd say late next year we'd be coming onto the market for North America. We've got some of the best people in the world that know the automotive industry inside out as far as setting up dealerships and
next year?
Yes.
You'll have it on the market next year?
We're targeting for late next year to see a production run.
How much? With all the options.
On a retail level?
Yeah.
We're talking basic commuter at $24.95. The sky's the limit. You can probably deck out your car like a Mercedes at $4,000.
$2,500 for a brand new car?
That's right, yes.
So the Murchie car hasn't died after all?
No, it hasn't died. I believe it's progressed since John has started it a year ago. It's just the beginning. And with its safety factor of being raised to a Formula One and putting the steel where it should be, separating your safety structure from your body so your body can be as light as possible, and that is your aerodynamics and your aesthetics, which is important, I think, in attracting the consumer to today.
How many people will it seat, two or four?
Five. It's a five-passenger car, and the door is the key to the body because it's strategically positioned and wide. You can
and it slides up. He was going to get a patent on that last time we talked to him.
It is patented
now,
and we're now solidifying on the world market.
Okay, why don't you get in and start her up and see if
sure.
We can drive away this thing.
Suzanne, is it a cereal?
Which is to point out that David Lewis is stepping into the car for the first time himself. There he is leaving Murchie's warehouse.
Not as good as me, though. He didn't hit the doorpost. And the marzipan thing is gone.
It's gone.
So it's a $24.95 habitat.
$24.95.
Habitat.
Habitat.
What's a habitat?
It's a habitat on wheels. Speaking of mobile homes.
Okie dokie, always good. Enough about mobile homes this year. Dip and dive with our mobile homes. No, thank you. Keep your mobile home. Now, next, what we'll do. Back to a little bit of humor. What we'll do next? We're going to do the road. I want to explain to you why I drove up to the studio this morning in what is now Dave Brown's armor-plated, bullet-proofed Rolls Royce. Now, Dave made a mention of the fact that he's a Webster addict, as he should be. He's really quite bright. And Sir John Ford, the High Commissioner, hold this for a minute. Sir John Ford, the High Commissioner, was on this program and said he wanted to sell his rusty old Rolls Royce. So I asked him to look into the camera and say, give me a 30-second commercial. And after that, Suzanne Boyce, the producer of this show, had a brilliant idea. She sent down to Ottawa for pictures of the Rolls Royce driving around, had it edited here with Land of Hope and Glory behind it, put on the air, as a result of which Dave Brown bought the Rolls-Royce from the British High Commissioner. Here was the sales job. I'll give you 30 seconds to do a quick, sharp, sharp commercial to sell the Rolls-Royce.
For a car which I reckon you would cost nearly $200,000.
It's a unique car that'll triple in value in 5 years and be worth a fortune. At the same time, give you care and protection and guarantee that you're not shot at. My Rolls Royce is it. So send in your bids to Ottawa.
And as a result of that, Davy Brown bought the Rolls Royce. I think he paid $60,000 for it. Now, next cue. What's the next cue? Was it still there? Oh, that's this morning. Okay, next cue. Steve Wyatt and I had a great idea of speeding up the ALRT route from Vancouver to New Westminster in 2 minutes and 15 seconds. But we want to show you a little bit of it this morning as to how Steve's car managed to make that journey on the ALRT route in 2 minutes and 15 seconds.
Coming up on 10, T-minus 10, 9, we have go for main engine start. We have main engine start. Minus 3, 2, 1. We have ignition. We have ignition of the solid rocket boosters and liftoff. Liftoff of America's space shuttle, and the space shuttle has cleared the tower.
That editing and the idea came from our editor, wee Jeannie McDonald, very bright lassie. Now I'm going to go to the phones. Yes, go ahead, please.
Is Mr. Webster there?
Of course I'm here.
Can I speak to him?
Well, of course you're speaking to him.
Am I on the air yet?
Yes, you're on the air now.
Is this really you, Jack?
Is that you, Crispo?
Yes, it is.
Put that phone down over there and come onto the set here.
I'll be right over there.
Okay. In the meanwhile, we'll try another call. Smithers, go ahead from Smithers.
Good morning, Mr. Webster.
While Crispo is dotting over the set.
I beg your pardon?
Yes, go ahead from Smithers.
Okay, how are you this morning?
Fine.
That's good. We've got a bit of a problem here. I don't know whether you can help us with it or not.
You've got a problem. I've got Crispo here.
Oh, have you?
Yeah.
We belong to a service club in Smithers.
Service club in Smithers.
Yeah. We run the bottle depot, which...
Beer bottles?
Yes. Taking in beer bottles and pop bottles and whatnot.
Well, I'm not going to buy them from you.
No? No, we don't need that. Our monies that we generate from this are supposedly will be going towards a swimming pool development or complex.
What are you talking about, a swimming pool in Smithers when it's 10 below?
Well, we can still use it during the summer. We don't need it right now.
Is this a serious call this morning?
Yes, it is.
You do me a favor?
Yes, sir.
Wish me a Merry Christmas and write me a letter.
All right, I'll do that. Merry
okay,
Christmas.
God bless. Good morning, John.
Good morning, Jack. How are you
this morning?
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
All right. Apart from you and me, who are the goofs of the year?
Oh, my God. Well, I think you'd probably agree the biggest one may turn out to be Alan McKechnie and his budget. Remains to be seen.
He'll backtrack on most of it.
Well, yeah, but if we could be serious for just a minute, if he backtracks on all the loopholes...
Must be serious for just a moment.
All right, just for for a moment.
All
if
right.
he backtracks on all the loopholes, he better raise that maximum marginal rate again. The only reason he lowered the maximum rate, supposedly, was because he was closing the loopholes. Now the wealthy could really rip off the country. They get the loopholes back, and they get the lower rates again. So that could
That's
be a big
That's a very good point.
Yeah, well, you watch what the establishment does. They'll roll them back and what they want to roll them back on, and then they'll make them leave what they want out of it.
Loophole McKechnie.
Loophole McKechnie. And then there's Joe Clark. You and I disagreed on this. Joe did yeoman service this year, but I still felt he should have got out of the way. The question is, will he get out of the way next year?
Is yeoman in Saskatchewan? Yeoman.
Yeoman, wherever you want to put it.
I see.
He stopped Trudeau on the Constitution for a while, slowed him down, got some concessions out of him. But I don't think Joe could win. I don't care what the polls show. If the Tories really want to take the country, they got to find themselves a more attractive leader.
How do you like it, BC?
I love it in BC. Keep that road open this afternoon. I'm going to Whistler. And if it isn't open, I'm going to hold you personally responsible.
If you think we're going to put in a $20 billion road to Whistler to protect American investments up there, you got another thing coming.
Just put a road up through the water area. Yes, you can. It's flat country.
You
that would never be closed.
Obviously from the east.
I want to ski Whistler.
You remember the dirty, smelly water you drank in Ontario?
What do you mean? I've been drinking it here for the last few weeks.
And
there's no road there.
There is no acid rain in British Columbia.
We'll ship it out here when we have too
much. No doubt you will.
But just give me a decent road to Whistler.
It's
in your national, your provincial interest. You want Olympics someday? You got to have a way to get
there.
You want
to go to Whistler? Walk from Horseshoe Bay.
I'm driving this afternoon, and you better get me there.
Take a rowboat from Horseshoe Bay.
Well, I'll do anything I have to, as a matter of fact. If they stop me by car, I'll find another way.
I am not seeing anything inimical to the interest of the decent people who live between here and Whistler. The nice gentry, the honest folks of Lions Bay, Squamish, Batanga Beach, M Creek, and all those places.
Are you running for public office up that way or something?
No, but I got to protect my image.
All right.
Are there any calls? Yes, yes.
Yes, Mr. Webster, please.
Speaking. Speaking. Speaking.
Hello.
How are you this morning, sir?
Yes. I was just going to ask about the BC ferries, but the BC ferries are not working at the moment.
I'm going to the island. What do you mean? They're not stopped?
Yes, I have to turn my voice down very quick. I may talk to you off the air, sir.
Gladys.
Gladys,
that calls for you, Gladys. Gladys, why do you keep giving me your relation to your personal calls? Really, Gladys, show a little more consideration. How about this? Here's a place you've never had.
What's that?
Solista, British Columbia.
No, I haven't heard
Go
that.
Ahead, please.
Hello.
Hello.
We're having trouble with our TV, and as you're taking all kinds of calls this morning, every time they impose any lettering or writing
I've noticed that too.
It's awful noise up here.
Every time you put up a super, you get a little on your set.
Yeah.
I don't suppose there's anybody around here who could explain that.
It's something in the...
Stanley, what causes that? When you put up a super, sometimes just... Stanley Blackwood, is it? What's it? It's quite... Can you put a camera on, Stanley? No, you can't, can you? Because it's really quite funny, Stanley Blackwood. Turn around, Stanley. Stanley, turn around. It's the automatic game control in your television set. It's not the fault of the impeccable... That's Stanley Blackwood. It's not the fault of the impeccable signal transmission put out by BC TV. How is the weather in Solista?
Oh, beautiful.
Where is Solista?
Oh, way up east of Chase.
East of Chase, BC?
Yeah, but we've been putting up with this for about 3 months, and we can't find anybody that can do anything about it.
You go to the television repairman in Chase and tell him that Stanley Blackwood of BC TV...
We've already done that.
No, you tell him he'll know Stanley's name. You tell him Stanley Blackwood said it's the automatic gain control on your set which needs adjusting to present...
Because everybody's got it. They've got it in Chase and they've got it all over the place.
Well, would you write Stanley Blackwood a letter and he'll answer in technical detail for your local TV man?
Well, where do I... but it's coming... It seems to be coming from Vancouver.
No, it's not coming from Vancouver.
Well, it's...
the name of our, where's Takayuchi? What's his name again?
Where do I write to him?
Wait, later on in the program, I'll have Taknagora on. Taknagora, he'll tell us what's wrong with that thing, whatever it is.
Yeah, I wish he would.
Well, if Stanley Blackwood can't, Taknagora must. Where's Tak when you need him?
Blackwood.
No, get Tack out of the coffee shop. John, thanks very much.
You're welcome.
You've been a great help this year. I'm a little bit crazy, but it's fine. Okay, next to break, and then Tack Nagora.
Hi, Jack. I want to tell you what a great pleasure it is for me to bring you Christmas greetings from all of us in the Eastern Media Mafia. Is that okay? Who is this guy, Jack, anyway?
Studio now, the man who must give us the answers or else to that vital question from Solicitor BC, and in fact it is a serious question, sometimes happens on my new fancy television set, and with me in the studio now is Tak Nagora. Good morning, Tak.
Good morning.
Nice to see you on camera. I didn't know you had a secret ambition to be in showbiz.
Not at all.
Not at all. The woman from Solicitor BC says that every time we put up a super on the program, a name or whatever, or some kind of fancy gimmick, the set goes.
Yeah, it does happen. Stan Blackwood is correct. It is the automatic gain control. However, I was just informed before I came down here that the translator at Solista is overmodulated, but that's not our responsibility, unfortunately. It belongs to the society up there, and they should get somebody to go.
The translator is the thing that takes the signal and feeds it out.
From Kelowna and feeds it out, yep.
The translator, which brings the signal from Kelowna out to Solista, is over-modulating,
yep,
and is over-modulating on a translator, which causes go.
Yeah, that's right.
So therefore, those who run the translator at where?
Solista.
Kindly correct your automatic gain control facility because it is over-modulating. Now you know what happens when your television gets sick. It was funny. I'm next to the. Leave the microphone behind you, Tak. I know you're short of microphones. And I do you just unclip it. So you've got to tell Vice President what to do. Unclip it. Give it back to me. Push back your chair, but don't fall off the set. And a Merry Christmas.
Send
and tell Ernie Rose I was asking for. Okay, next. In Stevie. You've got a voiceover to do of some kind, about which I don't yet know, and which I'm highly suspicious. And what kind of account does he get into this voiceover?
Well, the producer of this program said I didn't need a mic.
Oh,
been working in television.
Oh, yeah, it's very bright.
Yeah, it's been a long year.
Yeah.
No, we've got something here. We were trying to find out something that we could get you for Christmas.
I see.
For the man who has everything. It can be difficult sometimes. And we found a likeness and a familiar phone. And Bonnie Beckman is a sculptor. And this is her interpretation of you. You talk about your jowls and camera level sometimes.
That's remarkably good.
And I think Bonnie is here now with this sculpture somewhere.
Is Bonnie here?
There she
Where's
comes.
Bonnie? Bring
there
in another
now.
Chair. Tell Suzanne she needs a microphone too.
Here's Bonnie now.
Oh, Bonnie, I saw you. I didn't know who you were this morning. Oh, that's fantastic. We'll take it on camera one. Hey, that's... The bottom comes off of some ball bearings.
There
you
go.
See that? Can you reduce him and put me over it and see what...
So, Jack the Webster, I thought your last name is becoming a noun, so rather than Jack the Ripper, I thought it would be Jack the Webster.
I think it's a perfect likeness.
It's supposed to be you having another boring call that you can't hear. I don't know whether you're hanging up or picking up. I think you're hanging up on something.
That's remarkably good, Bonnie. Tell me a little bit about yourself. What's that made of, by the way?
Well, it's clay. It's all clay, fired clay, and it's coated in it with a ceramic glaze. And
My story is that I was actually a working Josephine for most of my adult life.
What's
and
a working Josephine?
Well, instead of a working Joe, I figured
oh,
I'd
oh, you're
a
working Josephine.
Josephine. My uncle used to call me Rosie the Riveter. I was working in a truck assembly plant for the last 2 years, and then I got laid off, and I figured it was time to be an artist.
I think it's time to write the truck assembly plant. No, it's very good indeed. Eyebrows are right. Oh, you've given me my third chin.
Well, this is funny. You see, when I first did it, I had the whole... See, I work in the storefront studio. I have... It's right on the Commercial Drive street. And so I had the whole neighborhood in to check it.
So they wanted to see you.
Yeah, and everybody... Like, I had you a little bit slimmer, but everybody said, do something with the jowls. So I poked a hole right through your head and pushed your jowls out a little bit.
Happens to me every day around
I was going to tell you that I thought you were so thick-headed you'd blow up in the kiln, but I decided not to tell you that.
Who's been feeding you the lions? Who's this sweet fella?
Now, I thought I'd bring this just to show what I
yeah.
do. This is a little portrait of a little boy in the neighborhood. The mom's had it made for the father for Christmas. It's called Aaron and the Beanstalk.
That's
and you can see the likeness.
Can I see it now? I'll put it off the camera.
Sure.
Oh, yeah, there he is.
He's supposed
together.
To be standing in front of a beanstalk in their backyard.
That's great. What's his name?
Aaron.
Aaron what?
He's
got Aaron Water.
No, it's something.
That's magnificent. Wow, so whoever did it there asked you to do it. I'm very grateful to you indeed.
Now
that's
I brought you
I
something else. This I thought maybe I wouldn't be controversial enough, so I brought something that I thought might engender some heated conversation here. Especially with your guests from yesterday.
You want to take over this program?
When are you leaving? Is Trudeau quitting too?
Yeah.
I'm waiting for both.
Where are you on a wet Monday morning when I need somebody?
I'm watching the program.
Good.
I also have done cartooning for a long time.
Oh, did you do the social credit calendar for 19?
Well, I did December of 82. That's Dan Campbell.
That's December of 81.
No. That's 82. This is
oh,
the Dan calendar
Moore,
coming
yeah,
out.
Yeah, that was when Dan Campbell wouldn't say how $65,000 was spent. The $1,000 bill was just an oversight.
Yeah, and he was handing them out. So
he wasn't clear as Campbell. Campbell quits the Socrat post, still blaming me. Beck woman, that's you.
Yeah, here I got little cards here. See, my name is actually Beck Man. So
you made a Beck woman.
Well, I
you're Josephine Beck woman. I need your little cards.
Yeah.
Beck woman, storefront art studio. Gifts, jewelry, crafts, anything you want, you made in clay.
Even your mother.
Even your mother. 1319 Commercial Drive, Vancouver, BC. Beck Woman Storefront. Where is that, 13?
Well, it's not too far from Britannia. It's about a block or two
Isn't
south.
That smashing? That's terrific. That's as close as you'll ever get to me. At least you can't see my pot. Thank you very much, Josephine Beck Woman. For you, I don't know. Is it time for a break? Okay, take a break. That's great. Well now, you wonder why we're having a bit of a party on the 11th of December. Because we give you best-ofs during Christmas, good ones, and I take a holiday. We all need a holiday after any 3 or 4 month session of doing 90 minutes live television a day, and I kid you not, it's not nearly as simple as it might on a good day look. We've got a great crew here. No exceptions. Everybody's good. I'm the best, but everybody's good. Now, we're going to look back over the year, and I hope this works. I'm going to bring out some selected clips from interviews. And the first one I'm going to tell you was, well, first of all, a little background. We went with the crew to Scotland this year, and we were treated right royally by a wee man called Michael Kelly, the Lord Provost of Glasgow. And the crew here, including Bice, the producer, really staggered me and made me absolutely speechless one morning on the first show on September the 8th, when the following... Don't forget, I'd interviewed the Lord Provost in Glasgow, and I didn't expect to see him again until I was in Glasgow. But they got me away from my desk on a specious lie. And when I came back and went on the air, I was made absolutely flabbergasted with speechlessness when the following little thing happened.
So you really are a television producer.
Oh, my.
Hello, Jack. Goodness. How are you doing?
It's me.
Sit down. Sit down, please. Like, see all that stuff you did in Glasgow? I thought that was a con.
I'm absolutely shattered.
Well,
staggered.
Sit down.
That really was a surprise when little Michael Kelly, wearing a green kilt and his £25,000 chain of office, which he almost lost when he was in Vancouver, we didn't dare tell you about it, when he walked out the studio. I didn't expect it. I was totally and absolutely flabbergasted, and I hated the crew for all of 25 seconds. But on this morning, I do want to give you the odd laugh. Brought on a man recently who is James H. Boren, S-O-B-P-U. And that means School of Bureaucracy, P-U. And he gave me the motto we should all live by.
Ponder. When in trouble, delegate. And when in doubt, mumble.
And thinking on that, of course, I thought I would next bring to you a guy who has got an undoubted, but he wins this reward for whispering baritone, who has a Ph.D. in S-O-B. And here's what he said to me when I asked him a key question. When are you going to retire?
Well, I hope I'll be happy when I retire. And as to whether I'll rate, as you say, a footnote in history, I don't know. It'll depend on who writes the history, I guess.
When are you retiring?
When?
When? He said soon. I think he'll be there longer than I'll be here, I'll tell you that. And then, of course, earlier in the fall, we had Joe Clark, who had been unfairly tagged in many ways by the term wimp. So with the knowledge of Coote's defeat, the Liberal big boy being defeated, I put a question to Joe so he could bequeath the title of wimp to Coote's. What was his first name? Michael Coote? Jim Coote.
One short question. Have you any special words of wisdom this morning for the failure Coote's by name, who coined for you the description that Clark was a wimp?
I think that Jim might want to start up Wimp Enterprises and see if he can do better across the country with that business than he did in the Spadina by-election.
Joe, therefore, is no longer the wimp. The official wimp in national politics, very much on the sideline, is Jimmy Coote, who used to be the right-hand side of the PhD and SOB. And then I had a man who looks not unlike me, I'm afraid, called McDermott, the boss of the CLC. And I almost fell off my chair again when he suggested a form of anarchy in this country. So he's the biggest potential anarchist in the country when he told us on the Webster program the following little piece of dramatic information.
They've got to listen to this. And if they don't, then we're going to do it again. And maybe the next time we'll demonstrate inside the House of Parliament instead of outside.
I'll tell you that, even Davy Barrett says, but damn it, don't be stupid. If you demonstrate inside the House of Commons, it still won't bring down the interest rates for anybody in this country. But the name of Skulbania came to my mind in a nice, friendly manner. And I thought at the time, you know, if you can be a quarter Indian blood, you've got all your claims to land deals in British Columbia. And after I had spoken to Joe Mathias and a couple of others, I thought, I hope Skulbania isn't in a position to make a claim for land, and he'll hold me whole of the province. But here's what happened anyway, and I was flabbergasted between myself and the very decent and straightforward spokesman for the Indians down here.
You're not really going to claim Stanley Park.
Definitely.
Now, don't pull my leg.
No, not. It's a serious claim. Mind you, we have to strike an agreement between the Squamish people and the Musqueam.
Why?
Overlapping boundaries, overlapping territories.
Don't tell me the Musqueam people are going to take over the UBC.
Perhaps. They've already laid claim to that.
And your overall final claim, you'll throw in Stanley Park, even if it's only titular ownership.
False Creek, Stanley Park, BC Place.
You won't get it. I'll tell you that right now.
I could well be wrong. And if the Indians don't get it, Skulbania might get it. However, every now and again, I run across one of my former newspaper colleagues. I was, you know, at one stage, not the immaculate, beautifully dressed Webster you see today. I was an ink-stained wretch with grubby fingernails.
great activist, a great ecologist, a great advocate of this and that and the next thing, and his name was Bob Hunter. And 5 seconds from now, he turned up and I saw an awful difference in my friend Bob Hunter. Whatever happened to Bob Hunter? Our old orangutan, hippie-looking, living in a camper trailer somewhere, annoying the establishment beyond measure, advocating drugs as the great escape for the world. Whatever happened to him?
Well, he turned 40 a couple of days ago.
And now he wears button-down collars, beautiful suits, obviously lives in the greatest possible affluence. Carol Friedman, the ombudsman, is an impressive little fellow. I remember nagging him about the complaint his neighbors had about his roof design in his house at Old Bay. But I really got quite angry at him when I discovered from his report that one of his investigators had spent hour upon hour upon hour upon hour looking into the silliest little thing about a couple who wanted to get married in costumes as Kermit the Frog and, what's the name of that woman, Miss Piggy.
And he investigated it, and they finally decided that the civil marriage commissioner was right in not allowing them to be married in costumes of Kermit the Frog and Miss Piggy. And Carl Friedman and I had this right little interchange.
Have you got the time to look into this ludicrous business where a man intended to be married as Miss Piggy and the woman as Kermit the Frog, and God knows how many hours you spent investigating Marriage Act Section 17 and telling this odd couple you couldn't help them?
Well, there was a serious issue again in this case.
Now, what serious issue was? A couple of people come to you and say, I'm Miss Piggy and she's Kermit the Frog and we want the civil commissioner to marry us. Now, you're supposed to be looking into Gracie's finger. Here you're wasting your time on Miss Piggy.
If you just hold your breath, I'll tell you why.
Okay. I know I look like Miss Piggy myself, but let's be serious. But I got too serious. And then, of course, every time I put a microphone or a camera in front of a big, tall, lanky, outspoken fellow who is very prominent in the trade union business, I warn everybody to be ready to bleep. I happen to think he's the best union leader in BC, but that's beside the point in many ways. His name is Jack Monroe, and down at the BC Fed, he fooled me again. He's got the worst language of any guest on the show, save and except myself.
Are you not quite into saying that every two fishermen in a rowboat have got a local and a delegate?
I've been saying that for years, that every rowboat on the coast has got two goddamn delegates around here, and that's unfair.
I was lucky. All he said was... All he said was... a blasphemous phrase. And I didn't pick this clip, but I'm accused most unfairly around the station of being a chauvinist. Now, why do they call me a chauvinist? Because I treat men and women in precisely the same way. In other words, I'm just as rude to women as I am to men. But if you're rude to a man, that's fine. He can be rude back to you, or he can walk away, or he can sulk, or he can mope. But if you're rude to a woman, intentionally, that is a criminal offense. Having Emily with women guests, I just melt. Reba Dexter, 5 seconds from now. I don't know what's on this one. Probably no good. Because they picked it, I didn't. You're going to raise this dreadful caper once again of compulsory hiring of women firemen.
When we our mandate is not to include the firefighters in the policy decisions.
I think that's smart. Because if you raise that spectrum again, you'll get all kinds of people like me who say, even jokingly, I don't want to be pulled out of a fire by a nice, slim little woman who's 3 months pregnant who's only 4 feet 6.
Yeah.
I've always cooked. I've always done my share of diapers.
Good.
I've always been non-liberated.
Wait till you see what I get told when I get home.
I think I washed one diaper in 1947 and didn't wash it very well at that. That means take a break, you doughheads.
Webster, you better behave, because if you don't, I may drop in again unexpectedly at 9 a.m. Precisely.
Letter from a little girl who's fascinated by the music we use in the introduction of the show, and I'm just going to read you the first paragraph of her letter. My name is Anna Carlson, I'm 11 years old, home from school last week, saw your show, don't understand much of what's going on, I'm a figure skater, free skate test in 82, I like your music, if I send you a tape, do you think you could tape your music for me? Maybe someone at the station could. Anna Carlson, you shall have a music tape which you might be able to translate into use for skating. A nice compliment you've given us, Anna. Thank you very much. Now, I have a couple of other letters that I must use. The first one, I don't relish. It comes from a person, B. Morrison, in Victoria. Here we go. Dear Jack, oh, cheer up. I'm sure the natives don't want all that land. Stanley Park, PC Place, Empress Hotel. I'm sure they'd settle for a little land in Salt Spring Island with some sheep on it. Then here comes the crucial one. This is about a thing on the wall here, which you can't see at the moment, but we'll see shortly. Every time I watch a show, I wonder what's in the background. It looks like insulation stuffed in windows, bad quilting in the shape of an angel. It couldn't possibly be a painting, could it? For Mrs. Oscar Purdy of Fruitvale. There it is there. I'll take the next letter. Your program is usually listened to in this household, but lately we find it hard to concentrate because of that disgusted hanging on the wall behind or between you and your guests. For the life of me, I can't figure out if it's an old mattress crumpled up in a cell or a window grating, or is it a painting of someone's entrails? Just follow me. I hope this doesn't all fall to pieces. I hope I can get here. Yes, I can get here. I can make it. I'll take my microphone off. No, I'll take my microphone off. Can you follow me? This is so slick, it reminds me of... Hold the microphone. Make yourself useful. For a change. Down. Now, where can we get a shot? Can you see it? That happens to be a magnificently quilted, penciled, threaded painting of me. It's terrific. And that's old glass windows. Done by a friend of mine many years ago, and I resent strongly the nasty letters and remarks that these lowbrow people send me. However, I have here, which will make you even sicker, a magnificent picture done by, read the name in the front if you can read. Can you read?
Raymond Kale.
Raymond? So for those of you who object to my quilting, you're going to see this magnificent picture of this handsome young man instead. Is that understood? Don't write me any more nasty letters about quilting. Jono is shaking his head. You should see. You want the quilt. John wants the quilt. The quilt goes back up. You want the picture? I'll sell it to you for $50. I'll take a break and be back after the break. A number of you noticed the new kind of introduction we have to Webster Show, which gives some shots of us and me in various places, you know. And I got a letter the other day saying, who is that woman between the two men in the picture? Is that your sister-in-law in Scotland, the famous author? No, that's not. That's my wife in Vancouver, Margaret, who's just recovering from an illness. Coming along fine, thank you very much. But it's not my sister-in-law, it's my wife, Margaret. And next thing, I want you to come over here, Pamela. Come over here. Just stand there. I want you to watch something. First of all, take the sweat off my brow. Come on. That's enough. Now, I don't like the way you do my hair. You keep giving me a parting. I like my hair to be ruffled. I don't want to look like somebody walking up and down Robson or Davy. Make me look too handsome,
Pam.
Let's
take a poll.
No. Where's my party? Do I have a party? You put the party in.
Part falls.
Am I getting thin on the top?
No.
Okay.
Anyway.
Thank you very much for all your kind words. On the studio this morning, not my idea, but it looks magnificently Christmas. See, we're surrounded by poinsettias. Poinsettias? See poinsettias? Back again? Seaman? Don Hartwig. He's a poinsettia. He's from Flowers by Connie. Sitting beside the poinsettias, too, is a wee Irish lassie called Breda McCambridge, who was very helpful to us in a couple of shows this year, which we did down at the Hyatt Regency. Now, smile, Breda. Do we jig? Do we Irish jig? No, we Irish jig. Thank you very much, Don, and thank you very much, Rita. Thank you very much, everybody. Gives us an excuse to have an easier morning. You know, sometimes this program drives me crazy. So deeply involved in politics, and you know, much of it's a pain in the neck, that it's just a pleasant change to do something nice. Back after. We missed Freddie for a chunk of this season. Freddie Hatt, who's my studio director, and he ran into the steering wheel of a car and cracked his sternum.
Fractured it, sir.
Fractured it, and your wife got an injury too.
Yes, she got an injury.
How is she?
She's coming along fine.
How are you?
I'm coming along fine. Come
we missed you.
I missed you, Jack. Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year, and this is for you and the crew. It's a cake that she made for you.
She made for you. I've only got 10 seconds.
10 seconds. Merry Christmas.
Best of Webster all for the season. Back live with more Webster January 4th. Have a good Christmas, New Year.